First, I must thank Professor Rashad for two things. من 30 سنة أثناء ترقيتي لأستاذ البروجيكتور, which was the only thing that was available at our time, was out of order. وأستاذ الدكتور رشاد سلفنا البروجيكتور بتاعه من 30 سنة وقدرت أعمل البرزنتيشن بتاعتي, and he saved my life at that day. So I still recognize this for him and appreciate his courtesy always يعني. ولكن يصعب أن أنا أتكلم بعد أستاذنا الأستاذ الدكتور رشاد, which has given the most remarkable presentation for amyloidosis. Amyloidosis, the bad brother, or what's called the illegitimate brother for multiple myeloma, always unrecognized as usual, and it does not inherit much. But nowadays, it has started to be recognized by so many, and the treatment will start. So, without any due delay, we're going to go for amyloidosis. As mentioned by our professor, the term was fixed mainly by Rudolf Virchow, which was a very stubborn and strong man, and he delivered the word starch-like material, which is amylum in Latin, that resulted from the accumulation of a pathogenic amyloid, most of which are aggregate of misfolded protein in a variety of tissue. Remember the word misfolded. Fibrillar appearance on electron microscopy is another characteristic. Apple green, birefringence on Congo red, histologic staining, as well as it encompasses a huge number of heterogeneous spectrum of etiologic and clinical presentation that's still evolving nowadays. This disease defined as a fibril, a protein polymer comprising identical monomer unit or what's called the homopolymer, that functional amyloid play a beneficial role in a variety of physiologic process. However, sometimes this accumulation can be devastating and cause a lot of damage to the tissue. Amyloid is defined as in vitro deposition of material distinguished by the following: fibrillar appearance, amorphous eosinophilic appearance on hematoxylin and eosin, beta plated sheet structure as observed by the X-ray diffraction pattern or birefringence pattern, and the apple green birefringence on the Congo red histologic staining, as well as its ability to be soluble in water and buffer on low ionic strength. So this is a hallmark of the disease. All type of amyloid consists of one major fibrillar protein that defines the type of the amyloid. Polymerism that slightly vary, naive, this is the peptide, can occur with some inflammatory process at one stage or another. However, this abnormal protein folding, unfolding, folding, and unfolding, and then finally developing amyloid fibrillar deposition in layer is the whole class of the disease. There is also an important to understand that the same polypeptide sequence can produce many diverse and different characteristics of the disease. You can see here the characteristic notorious protein that is usually deposited, and what is in the second figure is what's called the correct folded protein, and in the lower figure is the incorrectly folded protein. This incorrectly folded protein by genetic study or illustration will eventually cause too much damage. Amyloidosis is a clinical disease. Amyloidosis is a clinical disease that is characterized by an intracellular deposition of insoluble abnormal protein. Many mechanisms of protein function contribute to the amyloidogenesis, including non-physiologic proteolysis, defective or absent physiologic proteolysis, mutational involving changes in the hemodynamic or the kinetic property and pathway that are yet to be defined. Here you can see that this protein secreted by the monoclonal B cell, the immunoglobulin plasma cell, this is the light chain, or the, what's called the amyloid light chain, or the AL amyloidosis, and it is mostly a lambda, and with a few cases it can be of kappa origin. However, the AL, or the amyloid light chain, should be recognized. Another issue to be recognized is what's called the trans amyloidosis, or the trans-thyretin amyloidosis. This precursor expressor protein is the normal or a mutant sequence of the transport protein trans-13 or the TTR, a transport protein that is sensitized in the liver and choroid plexus of the or the corneal choroid plexus. TTR is a tetramer of four identical subunits of nearly 127 amino acid each. Remember that point mutation in the TTR increases the tendency of the TTR to form amyloid tissue and to be deposited. Many diverse forms of this amyloidogenic TTR mutation has been recognized, namely 100 of them, and each of them is having diverse country. For example, in the Middle East, we have the African or the African American mutant form, which is the TTR VAL1222 in Latin, and this is also another form that is common in Portugal, Japan, as well as in Sweden. So each country have its own genomic type. Remember that this is a normally folded protein. Then it will go what's called the misfolded protein or the amyloid. Then the amyloid fibril will deposit. Eventually it will lead to spacing into the tissue and damaging the structure or the milieu of the tissue, leading to the amyloid syndrome. What the hematology need to know is that sometimes you are faced with macroglossia. A patient with macroglossia, periorbital vertebra, nail lesion can be seen in 3% of cases, submandibular swelling, alopecia, and jugular vein distension is also a common factor, as well as what's called the shoulder pad or the shoulder pad sign. Remember that sometimes false exophthalmos or amyloid deposition in the eye can be another alarming system, and also deposition of the amyloid in the laryngea of the patient. So the incidence of the disease is usually 1.2 per 100,000. The prevalence of amyloidosis was 1.6 per 100, and nowadays is increasing, particularly in Africa, to reach nearly 4 per 100,000. This was reported in 2015, and the incidence is rising by time. Mortality rate is quite high, and the mean age of presentation is usually between 55 and 60. Men, unfortunately, are commonly affected than female. Remember those appearances of a patient with amyloidosis. He's elderly. He's having what's called the raccoon eye, which we're going to see in the future. Amyloidosis, the clinical presentation, whether as Professor Rashad mentioned, AL amyloid light chain or ATTR amyloid trans 13, ATTR variant, as well as ATTR wild type, which are also now being recognized worldwide. However, AL amyloid light chain is the one that is concerned to the hematologist, because this is the one we aim to treat. Symptoms can vary from an atypical form or a monoclonal gammopathy like, smoldering myeloma like, diastolic dysfunction. But what is amazing is that this heart failure is recognized as normal ejection fraction heart failure. So do not be misled to find a patient with neck vein and manifestation of heart failure with proteinuria or a non-diabetic form of proteinuria, sometime neuropathy, autonomic dysfunction, hepatomegaly, berberic skin eruption, macroglossia, and the list is growing, including what's called the cow madness syndrome like, or the CNS manifestation. So almost every part of our body can be affected by this notorious protein, where in figure A you will find that this is intrinsically amyloid protein, which is the wild type of the TTR beta 2 microglobulin related, or the mutant form, and each of them will eventually lead to amyloid deposition, and this deposition will target specific organ with specific manifestation. So regardless, with this is apoprotein A1 lysosome related, immunoglobulin K light chain, or the TTR, all of them will lead to amyloid fibril. Those fibril have a special axis, geometrically placed axis. This transmission electron microscopy picture will illustrate it, as well as the polarized light microscopy that showed the structure that eventually led to misfolded protein that damaged the tissue. Here you will find this is an xerophilic interstitial amyloid observed in a renal biopsy that has replaced the normal normal the normal function in kidney and led to proteinuria, non-diabetic form of proteinuria. Mutant variant has been described worldwide, as Professor Rashad mentioned, and they are quite common, are quite variable, and they are distinguished in every part of the world. Each part of the world have its own category. For example, in the Middle East, where we have the familial Mediterranean fever predominance, as well as some renal disease, we have different form of amyloid diseases other than those in the other country. The classification of amyloidosis was first a clinical one, but nowadays it's based on chemical as well as genetic and new modality that lead to the distinction of multiple syndromes, including primary, secondary amyloidosis, hemodialysis associated amyloidosis, cardiac amyloidosis, and the list is growing, including senile, cerebral, endocrine, and other tissues that has different major fibrillar protein, starting from AL, AA, and the apolipoprotein, ATTR, ATR, and the list is growing for the major fibrillar protein that will cause this specific syndrome. But remember that what we are concerned is the nature of the protein, the chemical structure of the protein that will eventually lead to ocular manifestation, nephropathy, gastrointestinal, sensory, autonomic neuropathy, carpal tunnel syndrome, and definitely cardiovascular and CNN manifestation. Back to our main concern as hematologists, which is the AL amyloidosis, and the clinical presentation usually is impression from the teeth and the plate of the patient on the tongue of a macroglossic large mouse, as well as the bilateral periorbital vertebra, or what's called the raccoon sign. Here is another example of a congruent staining of a cardiac biopsy that has been obtained through a cardiac catheter, and it has shown that amyloid disease is deposited by polarized right in nearly all the myocytes of this patient, ending in what's called normal ejection fraction heart failure. Another example is what's called the pusicellular birefringent material amyloid in a skeletal muscle of the same patient. Remember, this is not the cardiac muscle, but also the skeletal muscle, and this biopsy was obtained from the tongue of that very same patient by a needle biopsy. Diagnostic approach has to be considered for this patient. We have to tackle the cardiac specific sign of amyloidosis, we have to tackle the renal manifestation of amyloidosis, and the non-cardiac manifestation, whether by urine or immune fixation, which we'll deal with later. Cardiac amyloidosis is an entity that should be recognized where the myocardium stained with congruent in a case of amyloidosis undergoing polarized light has an apple green birefringence, and in the meantime, when you go for the isotope study, as well as the what's called the gated bull study of this patient and the echocardiography, you will find that the cardiac sylvie or the cardiac size is not large. Heart failure without a large heart, but rather than that, the position is inside the heart, causing what's called restrictive cardiomyopathy, where the size of the ventricle is by far reduced, ending in a state of severe form of heart failure that demands specific treatment. Another example is what's called the sagospleen, the famous sagospleen that was recognized by Virchow, as well as the rhodesious spleen, which is another form of a bulk huge spleen, not an axis wise, but as a, but a transverse dimension wise. This is due to deposition of amyloid tissue in the splenic sinusoid of this patient. The kidney, of course, when you see it in A with the Congo red stain, and in B, viewing the same underlying polarized microscopy, and this is almost pathognomonic for amyloidosis of the kidney. The liver is also can be targeted by amyloid tissue, and you can find here this is a form of non-sinusoidal obstructive liver disease ending in liver cirrhosis, but with large organomegaly rather than cirrhosis. Cerebral amyloidosis is also an entity, as well as adrenal amyloidosis by biopsy. The raccoon is a cute animal. And remember, this is the eye of a patient with amyloidosis. And in this tongue, which is large, you will find at the lateral part the teeth of the patient embedded in those having their own mark on this macroglossic tongue. So remember, this is the eye you will see in a patient with amyloidosis, and this is the tongue of the very same patient. Sometime you will see a patient with a shoulder bed sign with pigmentation or without, but this is another sign for amyloidosis. And here is an upper extremity vertebra that is almost always occur with amyloid disease, upper specifically in the upper limb of those patients. Is amyloidosis a rare disease in Egypt? And the answer is no. It is a neglected disease, rather it is an uncommon disease. For example, in rheumatoid arthritis, clinical studies had shown that there is a lot of patients with amyloid diseases that harbor the definition of rheumatoid, whether seropositive or seronegative rheumatoid arthritis, and the majority of them are having amyloid A protein deposition in them, and even some of them will have AL amyloidosis. Not only that, but in 1912, an renal amyloidosis is uncommon in Egypt, and a 25-year study showed that no, amyloidosis is not uncommon in Egypt, and in fact, amyloid disease by type AA amyloidosis as well as AL amyloidosis constituted nearly 75% of the biopsied patient, and making amyloidosis a rather uncommon disease, but is a serious case for Egypt because it's always neglected and not treated or not approached normally. Most of those patients had a lambda type rather than a kappa type, and most of them had non-diabetic proteinuria, and in fact, this should be put in the differential diagnosis of any Egyptian elderly who have unexplained proteinuria. Not only that, but when they tested for the leukocyte chemotactic factor 2 amyloid, it was even, this is a very rare form of amyloidosis, yet it was found and proved by renal biopsy to be quite prevalent in Egyptian and always neglected. And you can see here that proteinuria was present in 70% of those patients, and some of them even presented with end-stage coronary failure demanding dialysis. So at dialysis, some of them had this notorious syndrome with dyslipidemia. Going for the future, now we should surpass Virchow after nearly two decades. Tissue biopsy is a must. Congo red stain and the Greenberry fringent under polarized microscopy. Immune histochemistry is now to identify the type of amyloid fibril. Genetic counseling is another important thing to confirm the mutant or the unmutant form of ATTR. And what's even more attractive is a whole bloody, the whole body, 1-3 iodine labeled serum amyloid B scintigraphy that is always can catch a lot of patients with amyloidosis. Not only that, 24-hour urine, immune fixation, electrocardiography, echocardiography, as well as troponin T and the natural peptide or the NT-proBNP that is have post significant diagnosis as well as for the follow of the patient. And the remember that prothrombin time and partial thromboblastin time has to be added because amyloidosis may hinder the coagulation profile of so many patients and even may cause a state of thrombosis or thrombophilic syndrome. In Egypt, the studied cases of amyloid diseases has shown that if you go for biopsy, the sensitivity of the test available in Egypt, abdominal fat bed yielded positive result in 80%, rectal in 70, bone marrow biopsy in 55%, skin biopsy in 50. However, renal and liver biopsy always yielded higher result compared to other form of modality. So in Egypt, it is the liver and kidney biopsy that come first, followed by the abdominal fat, and finally the bone marrow of some of those patients according to the disease. Here you will find that this is the what's called the technetium-99 BYB, which is a very important modality in recognizing or detecting amyloid tissue in the body. And what's even more attractive or sparkling is the development of a new PET-CT technology that is dependent on the 18F fluor beta pair. This is a very important technique that detects or targets the B amyloid in any part of the body, and this technology has been approved by an FDA. It's quite easy, and not only that, but even the Pittsburgh group have introduced what's called the 11 carbon or the radioactive 11 carbon Pittsburgh compound B, as well as the peptide B5 plus 14. They are the new modality to detect amyloid tissue and to settle the unconventional problem that can be detected in patients with amyloidosis. Professor Mervat Matar will tell us about the management, but I'm going to talk only about how to change science, which we have seen now, into reality. Remember that what's called the M-SMART is a newly diagnosed AM amyloidosis. This is the strategy that has been introduced by the International Society for the Treatment of Amyloidosis and started with the induction with daratumumab or the Cyborg 2-4 cycle, then stem cell collection for those who are eligible for transplantation, and remember that it is the create clearance that settle which patient to use melphalan or those who do not. If the patient left, go for the algorithm. Otherwise, this is the only available treatment. Treatment here rely on many factors. For example, you have to test for the high-risk cytogenetic. Remember, this is a myeloma-like event. Deletion 17B, translocation 414, translocation 1116, and most commonly, it is the translocation 1114 that has an impact because you are all familiar with venetoclax as a line of therapy for those patients. Small but dangerous clone are the characteristic of, unlike myeloma, here amyloid disease have small but dangerous clone and it's difficult to be treated. So to treat, you have to do rapid and deep response. You have to have a small, easier to get CR. Unmet need is always present, particularly for patients who are in the late stage due to renal or cardiac complication. The goal of the anti-plasma C therapy has to be recognized, and remember that you have a goal where you can test by flow cytometry as well as by the natural peptide or the pro-BNP, where the cardiac response includes at least more than 30% reduction and more than 30 nanogram reduction in the amount of the NT pro-BNP prior to the treatment of those patients or consideration. Those who have such an achievement, usually by 3 months landmark, usually will do by far better than those who did not achieve this or did not have achieved a very good partial response. So goal for therapy in green and measuring response is another issue. You don't treat amyloidosis without having a target. And the goal for therapy, as we have mentioned, durable, deep response with minimal toxicity and best supportive care possible. How to achieve this is by having a hematologic target, which is the reduction in the M protein by the protein electrophoresis, whether in urine or stool, urine or blood, as well as the flow cytometric parameter, organ response, the cardiac NT, pro, and B, septal thickness should be reduced by at least 3 millimeter, or the interventricular septum reduction, liver span, reduction in alkaline phosphatase is another surrogate, as well as the quantitative fecal fat and serum carotenes are a marker for gastrointestinal amyloid disease, while for the nervous system, EMG potential reduction of at least 1/3 of the amplitude should be thou, and for the renal, of course, the 24-hour proteinuria and improvement in the creatinine clearance. Those criteria will define which patient have what's called a good or a fair complete response, very good partial response, or those who failed to develop any response at all or could not have any diseases that should be considered to be treatment. Another example for the treatment, which will be mentioned by Professor Mervat Matar, is now evolving what's called the Andromeda study that has shown that we can treat newly diagnosed amyloidosis and we can treat them perfectly, and some of them will achieve a state of hematologic response as well as very good partial response. Then for the refractory relapse amyloid, the SMART or the M-SMART showed that if the patient is not fit for transplantation, you can go for the Lindex, you can go for the pomalidomide Dex, Cyborg, the drug. Not only that, but venetoclax has been introduced recently for the treatment of this. Current investigational drugs are quite impressive, and they have shown very promising response for those who fail to respond to the primary treatment, and one of the most important is the tafamids, which is a drug that has been recently introduced and has shown very impressive effect in cardiomyopathy-related amyloid disease. And that, not only that, this had led to that the drug has been approved by the FDA in the year 2020, and most physicians will treat it or use it as if we are using it for a myeloma patient. Chemotherapy-related drug, oral melphalan, dexamethasone alkylating, will be mentioned by Professor Mervat, as well as bendamustine. And remember that transplantation still play a very major response or curative, near curative response to those patients. And that the Mayo Clinic experience found that treatment-related mortality did decline for amyloid patient in the past few years. And in fact, the author concluded that it should be an important first line treatment for amyloidosis. Safety and efficacy of this technique has been approved, and pertuzumab as well as other lines of treatment are now being considered to treat the TTD, the VCD, and many other protocol has been used to treat patients with amyloidosis with fair response. This has led to an improvement in the overall response of amyloid disease in the past 5 or 10 years, and has led to demonstration of using multiple technique in the past 15 years will lead to better understanding of amyloidosis, as well as survival of the patient improved from 25% in a period of 2 years to an overall response rate or overall survival of 47 or nearly 50% of that. Not only that, but amyloidosis is now being evolved to include so many drugs, not only DARA, exazomib, carfilzomib, venetoclax, bendamustine, and even not only that, but the FDA has recently approved in the year 2019 the tafamid as a molecule that is now commercially available. Not only that, but the Omaptra, a new drug that has also been recognized. This is a class of drug that target RNA-based therapy and has been demonstrated by the Apollo clinical trial to be significantly improving the survival of those patients, and the drug is available in the IV form and can be used. The drug also includes a list of the beta-2M absorbing column, the enterostatin. This column has been used in dialysis specifically related amyloid disease, and the column is also target beta-2M absorption column is now being recognized for the treatment of amyloidosis. Immune therapy, many drugs are evolving. Not only that, but the carbon 11 labeled beta-spark compound has led to a new liver cell imaging, as well as newer drug for the treatment of amyloid disease with the inclusion of daratumumab, which is available in Egypt, that has joined the family of treating amyloid disease. This was introduced in January 2021, and the response rate can be up to 40 or 42% for those patients who fail to respond to the treatment. Dara and other line of treatment, including pertuzumab, will now joined by carfilzomib, exazomib for the treatment of myeloma. Thalidomide, lenalidomide, pomalidomide, and venetoclax has also been introduced, particularly for translocation 11, 14 in amyloid patients who are refractory. Remember that it's very important to recognize that patients with amyloid disease have very specific form of heart failure. They do not do well at all with beta blocker, and they get very worse when you use diuretic with them. They can go into a state of complete shock once they are challenged with another form of diuretic at that time. Calcium channel blocker has also to be used carefully. In cardiac amyloidosis, remember that it's very important to do the N-terminal pro-B-peptide, natriuretic peptide measurement before and after treatment. For renal amyloidosis, you have to achieve a less than 0.5 gram reduction in 50% decrease in proteinuria, and for liver disease, target the size of the liver as well as the alkylating the alkaline phosphatase for those patients and the management of amyloidosis in the year 2020 has been well illustrated by the American Society of Hematology, where the criteria of diagnosis, risk assessment, response, as well as follow has been done. So the orphan of hematology is amyloidosis, a disease that has now so many future, and as Albert Einstein once said, there is no cure, but we aim to change that. Be a voice, not an echo. Thank you very much. Thank you.